Permit me to welcome you all to our newest series, the BW Hotelier, the GM Show. The topic for the show is now debated all over, and if not, should be redefining existing roles from a specialist to a multitasker. Coming to this show, which will go on every Thursday now for the next few weeks, let me briefly share some of the saliences of the series. It'll be each Thursday with a new episode. The show will go live at 5 p.m. Indian Standard Time. I request you to please block your dates all Thursdays at 5 p.m. Each episode will have a different subject to be debated upon. Each episode will have different and the best in industry moderators and six of the finest GMs on each show will be part of the panel to debate and put forth their views. By the time we are done with the series, we would have brought to you over 150 of the finest moderators and speakers from across the country. This format is region-based. We start with two shows of the North. We move to the West. We move then to the South, East, come back to the North, West, South, East. We are bringing in a special focus this time on the Northeast and the Central region, and we shall cover them all. The show will be relayed live on Zoom, for which you need to register. It'll also be live on BW Hotelier Online, on all our social media. For post-show viewing of the recording, you can go to BW Hotelier Online and our social media. Without much ado, let us get rolling with this inaugural episode of the first GM show, Redefining Existing Roles, Specialist to Multitasking. This show will be led by Binita Sharma. Who doesn't know Binita Sharma? She, of course, is the area manager North for ITC Hotels and the general manager of the ITC Moria. I shall talk about her in a moment, but let me introduce to you briefly the six speakers, the six stalls general managers. Nayan Seth, who's the general manager with the Taj Palace, New Delhi and Binita's neighbor. Meena Bhatia, who's the vice president and general manager of the Lee Meridian in New Delhi, right? Vineet Mishra, just come back to Delhi after a stint in Pune. He is the complex general manager for the Pullman and Novotel, New Delhi, at the Aero City. Rohit Arora, stalwart of the industry, long-term resident of the Park New Delhi, right? He's the area general manager of the Park New Delhi. Anupam Das Gupta, again a Delhi boy, comes back. Actually he's been here. But now he's the general manager of the Leela Palace, New Delhi. Vijay Vanchu, some call him Chef Vijay Vanchu. He's worn many hats. Binita will speak about him. One of the senior most hoteliers, right? He is the Senior Executive Vice President and General Manager of the iconic Imperial. A bit on Binita now, right? Binita, like I said, is the Area Manager North for ITC Hotels and the General Manager for the iconic Moria. She started her career with the ITC Hotels as a Hotel Management Institute trainee from the batch, and she's from the batch of 1987. She has held senior management positions at several ITC hotels in various locations, setting definite and impeccable examples for her successors. Driven by creativity and quality of new inspirational upmarket trends, her endeavor has always been to cultivate and maintain the finest hotel operation. Binita brings with her management expertise garnered through international exposure at reputed institutions and maintains the finest hotel operations. Binita is the general manager of the ITC Moria, a landmark in itself, The hotel has been acknowledged as the preferred residence of visiting heads of state and global icons for over 40 years and epitomizes the luxury hotel experience in New Delhi. This luxury hotel welcomes guests to 412 rooms and 25 suites each, of which is a triumph of stunning aesthetics and contemporary Indian art. With the iconic Bukhara celebrated Dampuk, the hotel has an enviable collection of culinary destinations alongside magnificent conference and banquet venues, unmatched wellness facilities. She firmly believes that a leader should always lead from the front and try to bring out the best in the people who work with them. Vinita is an inspiration to many aspiring youth in the hospitality industry. A working mother in a demanding industry, she maintains wonderful work-life balance, doing justice to all her roles in addition to being a top performer of the chain. Vinita, this is your show. Here are the reins.
Thank you, Bhuvnesh. That was a nice write-up. I wish you were my boss. Anyway, to start with, I'd like to say good evening to our industry colleagues, friends, and our valued audience. We thank you for your support and look forward to the next hour with an experienced general manager's team. They're in the field at the helm, have survived both phases of COVID, and now on the path to a very early recovery. Multi-skilling is a concept that has always existed. It has regained greater focus in the survival, revival, and the thrive phase. Hotels need associates to be multi-skilled and contribute to the work outside their job profile. Cost-effective and efficient in terms of resource management. Basically, it is a consequence of this strategy that has helped us make it more cost-effective as well as resourceful. Multi-skilling helps in avoiding redundancies in the system, both for the guest as well as for the internal customer, and gives an added advantage to the hotel to encash at the time of contingencies, the one that has just gone by. Hotels have created a pool of employees that fit into a job profile, reduce pressures of absenteeism, and increase output. Multi-skilling leads to increased customer interface, safer guest interactions, and an enhanced guest experience is what we have experienced. Service quality is rated as the top advantage of this strategy. Interdepartmental teamwork increases with greater clarity of the objective and delivery towards a higher guest satisfaction. Research has proven that an increase in job satisfaction and employee retention, giving manpower opportunities to upgrade their knowledge and skills and discover an inner potential which they did not believe even existed. The hotels benefit with labor flexibility, which enables them to cope with an uncertain manpower environment. Without any further delay, let's get insights from some of the best leaders in this industry. Although these leaders need no introduction for the benefit of few, we will start with Nayan. Nayan, if you raise your hand, I know everyone knows you, but just for the benefit of few. So he's a general manager, as Bhuvnesh just told us, of the Taj Palace Hotel, my closest competitor. He is a general manager and of a defining city landmark for close to four decades, and one of the Indian hotels company's most revered hotel. With over two decades of prolific experience with some of IHCL's most iconic luxury hotels and palaces, Nayan is an admired leader in the industry and a veteran in the field. In his current role, he's responsible for the continued success of the Taj Palace New Delhi through his strategic leadership, ensuring margin enhancement and overall operational excellence. In his previous assignment, Nayan led the fabled Taj Palace, Lake Palace, Udaipur. Nayan began his career with the iconic Taj Mahal, New Delhi at the front office. He was promoted as the executive assistant manager, accommodations at the Taj Mahal Palace, Mumbai, after his inspiring and successful tenure with IHCL's flagship hotel. He moved back to the capital and managed the hotel operations of the iconic Taj Mahal, New Delhi, as the resident manager. In addition to the Taj Lake Palace, Udaipur, Nayan has been the general manager of Taj Wellington Mews Luxury Residences, Mumbai, and the Taj West End, Bengaluru. Nayan, like me, I guess you've known no other company but the Taj. Me, of course, ITC Hotels. Is that true, Nayan? Like me, have you been also only with the Taj?
Well, Nayan, yes, Life.
Okay, Life.
Correct. Good. And thank you. Thank you so much for your very kind introduction.
Nina, of course, needs no introduction, but she's the vice president and the general manager with the Le Méridien New Delhi. She's an accomplished hotelier with 4 decades of luxury hotel experience. She started with the Oberoi Grand Kolkata and then moved to spearhead the sales and as sales and associate director of sales at Hyatt Regency New Delhi. At present, Nina is the vice president and general manager at Le Méridien New Delhi. She leads the strategic planning, brand effectiveness, business development, and the operations of the hotel. Nina, I really need to learn a little more about this. She's been at the heart of driving transformational changes at the Le Méridien New Delhi from being a pure 5-star property to indeed an iconic luxury hotel. She has actively involved. She is actively involved with various associations and chambers. She's in the executive committee of the CII Indian Women Network, FICCI Ladies Association, council member of ICPB, and members of various trade associations like SCOL, TAI, FHRA, HR, and NAI, and HI. In her pursuit for community service and a passion for hospitality, Nina has embraced various societal issues. She's a part of CII's Delhi State Council CSR committee and will stay committed and bring positive change in the area of skill development and women employability. Vineet Mishra, the complex general manager, Pullman and Novotel New Delhi Aerocity. He's as if he's coming out of Hollywood, but he's actually a seasoned hospitality professional. Vineet Mishra brings on board an illustrious career spanning over 22 years and an exceptional network, has some exceptional network in the industry. In the cluster leadership role for Pullman and Novotel New Delhi Aerocity, Vineet takes charge for leading the overall operations, human resource management, directing sales and marketing teams, ensuring sustained recovery and growth for both the hotels. Vineet's rich body of work includes long, successful stints, strengths in business management, meticulous operational techniques, and his unique style of leadership with a team-first approach will help crafting extraordinary experiences and continue driving recovery.
Thank you. Good evening and very kind of you. Thank you.
Mr. Roy Darora, Area General Manager of the Park New Delhi. Welcome. 30 plus years of extensive experience as an astute and result-oriented professional, a hands-on leader focused towards innovation in all the realms of hospitality, leading the Park New Delhi of a successful city center boutique hotel and successfully has launched 2 premium hotels in Goa under the Park flagship. A visionary with far-sighted planning and a strategist attuned to latest market updates and trends. A stern believer in the people policy, hence enjoys a great relationship in the corporate and travel trade. Excellent interpersonal communication and management skills, both inter and intra hotels. He's a member of the executive committee of PATA, the Indian chapter.
Thank you, Vinita.
Anupam is an old colleague. Mr. Anupam Das Gupta, general manager, the Leela Palace, New Delhi. Anupam brings with him over 25 years of extensive hospitality experiences, has worked with leading hotels like the Oberoi's Grand Kolkata, Yakin Yeti, Kathmandu, the Trident Hilton Jaipur, Ananda in the Himalayas, Ista Hyderabad, ITC Vilasa, and then he goes back to the Oberoi's Anupam. Prior to joining the Leela, Anupam was the general manager at the Oberoi Mumbai. Over the years, Anupam has honed his skills in understanding nuanced luxury and is a highly motivated and a dynamic leader. Technically sound, he has pursued excellence, consistently ensuring that his team performs at the highest level. He has independently handled large operations and possesses an astute business acumen with a keen understanding of finance, marketing strategy, development, and communications. Passionate about talent development, he has mentored many industry leaders with ilam. Hi, Anupam.
Thank you for the introductions. Thank you.
Mr. Vijay Vanshu, again, a colleague who worked with us at ITC Hotels. He's a senior executive vice president, general manager, the Imperial, perhaps in this group, the senior most. He's an alumnus of St. Columbus School and IHMCM Pusa. Mr. Vijay Vanshu is one of the stalwarts of the hospitality industry and has been spearheading the operations of this beautiful hotel, the Imperial, over 11 years. And this is in his current second tenure. Post completion of hotel management, he was as a kitchen trainee by the Oberoi Hotels 1979 to 81. On graduating from the Oberoi School of Management as a qualified chef, he was offered the assignment of food and beverage instructor at the Oberoi School of Hotel Management. This is a true example of multi-skilling, if you ask me. He's a living example. He actually personifies what we are going to talk about today. Today, his experience in hospitality spans over 40 years. He then joined the Imperial in 1996 as the executive assistant manager. In 1999, he moved to ITC Hotels as general manager and headed the 220 Marriott Welcome Hotel at Sake. He also served as the general manager operations with Fortune Park Hotels, where he was responsible for operations of then 20 hotels. In 2006, the Lalit Hotels as senior vice president, and then back again to the Imperial as senior executive vice president and general manager since June 2009. Mr. Vanshu feels that an interesting phase of his career has just begun, and he hopes to add further value to the hospitality industry in India and contribute towards the betterment and growth in these challenging times.
Thank you, Vinita. That was very interesting. I think next time I need to put an intro for myself. Hardly a hotelier, but I'm happy to be amongst you all. That's a great introduction, Vinita. Why don't we start the session?
So to start with, do we create a jack of all trades and a master of few? Or do we create a specialist for one or two functions or roles?
So, Vinita, I think, you know, jack of all trades, master of none, orphan of one is a very, you know, it's a saying that we all have heard before. But I think in hotels, we are the ones who are responsible. We've been creating the specialists. So, you know, when they come from hotel schools, of course, you know, they come with a predetermined mind of what they want to do. But I think we make them the specialists on the job. And then we exploit that specialization because it works very well for us. And I think it's very seldom that we think of moving them or, you know, moving them around till they ask for it. I think COVID, amongst many other things, has taught us one more thing while we are in the process of right-sizing, I would say, not downsizing or anything, but right-sizing. Right-sizing because we have to manage the three big R's of revenue, recognition, and resources. So today, I'm going to only just talk about the human resource part of it. We know that globally, you know, everybody is viewing talent very differently. Organizations do not want employees with a single skill anymore because I think it is, they cannot afford to have that. I don't know how well we can adapt that to the hospitality industry because we are so, you know, though we are all masters of many things, you know, by default, we learn everything. We can be a good nurse. We can be good doctors. We can be, you know, we can do a lot of things while, you know, being in the
good
front.
Good counselors,
of course. I've even done marriage counseling in part of my guest satisfaction.
We are the agony aunts of any.
Yes. So we've done all of that. But I think, you know, we need to make our organizations more kind of alive and agile. So we really have to work on something different. And what I think is that while we do need our specialists, I mean, the kitchen is a specialized skill and a kitchen remains a kitchen. We have revenue specialists. We have specialists around the place. So I think we have to work on a kind of a mixology here. If you may, I think we have to follow the formula where we create a new genre kind of thing of hoteliers who are, I wouldn't say jack of all trades, but masters of all trades, who can be used as multi-skilled associates in guest service areas. So, you know, it again depends on how the organization wants to use this formula. How many specialists do you need and how many generalists do you need? You know, just like you have the butlers and you have management trainees, I think we could create a whole lot of people or associates below the line. You know, and what we are going to do is create very, very robust future for these people, because once they have mastered, I'm not saying again that they would be jack of all the trades. I think they would be masters of all these areas. And once they have done that, I think they are more versatile, they are more flexible, they are more future ready. And I think we will create a whole lot of leaders, good leaders for the industry. You know, soft skills is something that is common across all the roles in the hotel. We all know what are the soft skills, how hoteliers have to behave, whether they are an F&B associate or a kitchen associate or a housekeeping associate. But I think hard skills is something that we train them for. And I think if we can hard skill training can be across a few, and I'm not saying all, across a few departments, I think that will give, you know, make the organizations very robust, and they'll, you know, make us more resilient, make us more strong, and will also make our people more strong. So I think that is something we need to do for the industry, for their own growth and for the organizational growth. Again, I think it depends on the service style, you know, from luxury to a lifestyle hotel, from an urban hotel to a resort hotel, from a budget hotel to a five-star deluxe hotel, how you use the formula, what percentage of generalists you use and what percentage of specialists you use, just like if you have a cricket team of, you know, special batsmen and then you have all-rounders, it depends on a T20 match what you use and, you know, in a test match what you use. So I think everybody will use their own formulas, but I think it is time to create agility and build resilience better. Of course, I think, you know, we have surprised ourselves the way we have come back from COVID and the way we all have recovered without any help or any state help. I think we should be all proud that the industry has stood back very strongly. And I think to make ourselves future ready, we should create generalists, guest service associates that can help build the organizations better.
Okay, what are the advantages, pitfalls, downsides, and repercussions of creating multi-skilled, multi-tasks?
Okay,
multi-skilled specialists.
So, of course, the advantages and the upsides far outstrip the disadvantages. While we are talking about operational functional areas, we are also looking at non-operational and other functions such as IT and HR, which I'll talk about later in a subsequent time. However, of course, the most obvious advantage is the cost optimization, which fixed costs that form such a large part of our cost structure and manpower forms such a large part of that. That, of course, is the most important thing that we can look at, rationalize, and that's the biggest advantage. Career development through motivation, retention, and self-actualization of an employee can happen through multitasking and, you know, through, by creating generalists. Cross-functional teamwork is another thing that happens, and you touched upon it, Vinita, in your introduction to the subject. I think that is so important because silos are smashed. The guest experience is not through any silo. The guest experience is this horizontal line, so to speak. And we unfortunately have silos that we've created, and people tend to live in those silos. Far better interpersonal skills because people, you know, they build empathy when they work in other departments, and they get to learn other areas and understand problems that occur in other areas. And it, of course, rounds off knowledge and exposure in many ways. From the guest experience we spoke about, it is, you know, cross-functional training and multitasking ensures that moments of truth are seamlessly delivered. And the hotel team, you know, gets to deliver all of this absolutely in a beautiful way. And the guest experience is truly enhanced. Most importantly, in my opinion, we can create better leaders and coaches through multitasking, because somebody who's been through a multitask environment will be able to explain and understand and empathize with people coming their way. And as leaders, I think that is our biggest responsibility, which is to leave our chairs, you know, better enhanced with leaders of the future. And I think that can only happen if the leader himself or herself has a sight to other functional areas. In terms of the downsides, I think we need to have better expectations that are managed through mapping of the career path. Because today, more than any other time, I don't want to use the word millennials, and you know, I don't want to sound dismissive or anything at all. But it's just that people, the team members coming through today, are wired differently from what we were. Their expectations are that much more different. Their idea of cause and effect is that much more different. They just don't have the patience to sow something and then wait for to be reaped, the benefits to be reaped. So in terms of expectations, management of expectations, I think that is important, because this can easily go the other way and cause frustrations and disappointment if this is not managed. Also, we need to make sure that the multi-skilling program is an ingrained program through the entire value chain. And it's not used as a knee-jerk and one-off thing in one particular hotel. It has to be across the chain and across the entire value chain, as it were. You know, it's a mindset that we need to inculcate from day one. And only then can it be successful. So while the advantages are many, there could be serious pitfalls if we don't manage it.
Is it time that the hospitality schools in India and overseas start creating multitask specialists with an exposure to a befitting training environment?
So what I feel is that schools, whether they are national catering colleges or the private institutions, the way their curriculum is designed, they kind of expose the students to all the areas, you know, and the training that is imparted to them is for all the operational areas and even certain non-operational areas of the hotel functioning. However, what happens is that it is, and even the while they come for the industry exposure when they come across to the hotels, they are still exposed across multiple departments. Probably after that, it is where they start finding their own comfort zones. You know, suddenly one has a liking for the kitchen, somebody has a liking for front office, somebody is food and beverage enthusiast.
Or he believes he has a liking. He's not quite sure. But Sorry? He's been, he believes he has a liking. A
Probably,
lot of them,
yeah. Probably.
I'm not too sure.
Probably. And I think so, even when they get back to the institution, this is exactly what happens, is that, you know, somewhere they are kind of tutored or asked these questions, okay, what is your preference? This is where you should focus, whatever. What needs to be done is probably do a little course modification with regards to kind of not guide them into a singular department, but probably still keep those things open in a way that, yes, you should be ideally multitasked and you know, and not look at a singular department, but cutting across at least two or three departments, whatever best can be done, because the exposure and the curriculum and the knowledge is of multiple departments. Having said that, you know, these things are practiced in most of the organizations. I can only talk about IHCL, as I mentioned, and you rightly mentioned in the beginning that I've been there. So in our scenario, whether it's, and we have done multiple programs like There were accommodation training, which we took, we used to do in front of housekeeping. And they would kind of cross work. Even our HDB or hotelier development program that we run, the students who join that program are exposed across various departments. Now, and we have enough and more examples where they've started from one department, let's say operational department, moved into sales or vice versa. So these things are already happening. They are very much there. And it's just that, yes, I agree with the fact that while the schools are imparting that training, it's just the way that it has to be modified a little bit.
Implemented at the ground level.
Yeah, at ground level, a little mindset change when they are being inducted into the industry.
Is the hospitality HR alive and geared up to take on this new shift from specialists to multi-task specialists?
So, Benita, what actually used to happen was that once an associate would join and start his journey right after what Nayan mentioned, after getting an understanding that, yes, so-and-so discipline is my passion and I want to continue with it, we would kind of, in a HR perspective, try and keep that person boxed into this for a fairly long time because of two reasons. One, we didn't want to take a risk. And we felt that since he's taken this path, let this path be for the future. But I think the last 18 months has really taught us something very different. We all went into a shutdown. We all started working on limited resources, including our own teams, where we had bio bubbles and people could not travel, or we actually right-sized positions. And that's where we all, I think, noticed as HR leaders as well, that people can do a lot of other things too. I mean, for example, I think in each of our hotels, at a certain point of time, we noticed that the gym trainer could be an extremely good person who's helping out in housekeeping or looking after the security person actually helping in food and beverage, so on and so forth. So basically the passion of hospitality, what we had actually started with Meena mentioning about the soft skill training was always there. And it kind of just shifts gears as we move forward. Every time someone would come across and say, you know what, this is the discipline I was in so far, but I want to shift. I think the first thing which we used to feel was a bit of a risk to it. Seeing that, will that person survive this? Will he be able to do so and so? But at the end of it, I think the foundation of hospitality is service from the heart. Anything on top of that just kind of gets added on as a hard training which comes in. And yes, we very often hear chefs and moving from culinary into other areas, but we rarely hear someone else from another area moving into culinary. But why is it not possible after 5 years of training in one specific area and then honing your skill? You've got excellent talent. If you've got passion, you can follow that through. So I personally feel it's more of a mindset where we need to kind of broaden our horizon. And I think each one of us looks for talent and is always hiring and looking for the right person. But once this person is with us and say 12 months after being with us, he says or she says, you know what, I want to move from here to another industry. Do we actually give them an option from our side saying that, okay, maybe such and such thing is something which you really did not enjoy initially, but we have other aspects of hospitality and we've got so many departments. We've got a whole world of opportunities amongst ourselves. It's just about, are we proactively taking the risk towards us and success for the individual to continue with us in hospitality? And I think it's time that we actually start looking at it in that perspective and taking a little bit more chance and putting a little bit more trust into people for being successful.
You're right. It is us who need to receive this better and keep an open mind to what a person is capable of.
Sure.
Mr. Rohit Arora, would you like to take this question?
Yeah, sure.
At such a stage of their professional career and experience, how do you propose to create multitaskers from specialists?
Well, you know, when we say that from a multitasker to a specialist, see, there's no denial that everyone feels that especially being a specialist is something which is a unique quality and which sets you apart. You know, means somebody is too good at sales and somebody is too good at in operations. But having said so, now that in this kind of time, it is very, very important that we should wear many caps. So whether it is an operations or it is a sales and marketing, or now in this world of a digital marketing, I think the younger generation is whether they are our associates in front office or they are associates in F&B, they are too good at it. You know, means these people are too good. They have much, much more knowledge than all of us. And they are quite intelligent in these terms. And these resources come at no cost. So just to give you an example, so I have created a team of say 6, 7, 8 people, which is a digital marketing team at the hotel itself. So apart from their own jobs, they are taking care of the social media, they are taking care of, how to manage the guest comments and stuff like that. So in my opinion, and I have also gone through this because from operations to sales and then to marketing and then back into operations. So I guess, yes, we have to create multitaskers, but yes, there will definitely be a need of specialists in our industry.
Thank you. Mr. Vanchu, the next question is for you. Can you name the top 6 challenges and opportunities with multitasking?
Firstly, Vinita, you know, we've all been through this change over the last 1.5 years. I remember the last year, March, when all this started, and we were really not going in. We were going into the situation without knowing what we are going into. And for many months, the hotels were literally shut, or we were dealing with, you know, the various rooms coming in for, from the government, from the DDMA, if you all remember that. Yes, the challenges that we have faced and are continuing to face is there is a bit of a turnover at a certain level in my hotel. I'm talking about the Imperial. There are people leaving at the GSA and GSE level. And I think the biggest challenge here comes is to retain them and to train them. Now the training has moved out of the training room into operations. And that is one challenge I am facing currently to keep that army of people, motivated. And it has not been very easy, to be honest with you. Hotel like ours, there are many people who have not been reported because they were, tied down with personal commitments. So right now, those challenges continue. We are managing it. But like I said, training is very, very important at this stage. Understanding the customer profile is very important. Our profile of our customer at the Imperial has changed 360. You know, we've got a completely different guest profile. When we say that we are getting used to a new guest profile, I think the guest is getting used to us, without sounding, you see, there are the hotel has been used to seeing 90% foreign travelers in the last 30, 40 years. And I think that's the biggest challenge I've faced, where you've got to change the mindset of the staff to handle this kind of profile. Controlling costs is very, very important. At this stage, the new the pandemic guidelines that came in, I think that is something which we really had to put together. And to get the staff to get used to it, I think that was one big, big challenge. And now, of course, people are kind of got used to it. But I am trying to teach people to smile through their eyes through all the masks that we have to wear and the screens on the front desk. I think those are, we all got used to that, and I hope it doesn't stay for too long.
You voiced the disadvantages very well. For paucity of time, since we've got a fair amount of opportunities as well as the advantages, can I move to the next person, if that's okay with you? How can we make multitaskers out of salespeople, PR, MarCom, and secretarial functions.
Absolutely. I think this is a no-brainer and very easy. It can be done. And I have live examples of having done that in the hotel. So I think I very firmly believe that a director of sales has to know the hotel, the operations, and you know, the way all the departments very well.
An example. You're a living example.
I am an example, and I have created.
And you inspire people as well.
I will tell you, you know, from the very first year that we hire people in the front office, I start eyeing them for moving them here and there. So that's something that I really love doing. And yes, so I think director of sales could be an idea, could move into front office role very easily. Even an executive housekeeper, why not? I mean, after all, they are selling a service and they better know the service that they are selling. Secretarials, I think we all know that secretaries have very little role right now these days. In the current scenario, we manage our own calendars and diaries, mostly databases on the phones. Yes, but we still sometimes need help. We've created a pool, and if you have to use secretaries, why, they can move into your, they can manage the spa, they can manage the salon, they can manage front office, they can, I mean, depends on where the talent can fit in well, you know. So somebody has put a question out there that where can an engineering person move? I think where an engineering person may have some other talents and skills which can be fitted into some role or the other. And somebody
else, if he's commercially inclined, then
yes,
becoming a general manager will not be difficult for him.
Not difficult at all. And I for one, really encourage this movement.
I'll move over to Anupam again. There are critical functions which by education create heavy duty specialization. Just now, Meena just mentioned it, engineering, IT, finance, and procurement. How do we create multitaskers out of these people?
So I think there is broad consensus that multi-skilling and multitasking in core operational areas are a no-brainer and really the need of the hour. I also believe that across other functional areas such as finance, HR, IT, there can be seamless movement. I mean, what is there for us to stop a guy who's, let's say an HR assistant or an HR supervisor wanting to, you know, who has a passion for finance, for example, you know, he can easily train in commodity receivables, payables, etc. Do an additional online course, they're available today, and then get absorbed into the system. There is absolutely no problem, especially between the finance, HR, and IT. Of course, for him or her to take on a role as the chief accountant or the financial controller, you know, you would probably have to do an MBA while you're at it, because the complexity of the job would require of that. But having said that, this can easily be done. It's just that we have to open our mindsets. The only exception where I feel amongst these areas where, you know, absorbing people into areas while it's easy in these areas, I believe that in engineering, lack of technical knowledge can lead to, you know, potential health and safety risks, not just for the asset, but also for people. And hence, you know, if they're desirous of learning about plant and machinery, they can certainly cross-train. But taking on responsibilities would mean a significant investment of time and energy to acquire technical skills to do the job. And that I'm not sure whether it's possible to do online, et cetera, et cetera. So while I'd like to leave...
In today's day and age, with the license, you also need some certifications.
Exactly. So that it becomes a little bit of a challenge for somebody moving into engineering, but vice versa, from engineering to another location, easily done. If they have the passion, we need to have the openness and, you know, to be able to guide them towards it. And which is why I feel job chats have to happen. As leaders, as coaches, we need to be able to meet people, not just once a year, which is customary during the appraisal, but also do job chats through the year so that, you know, people's aspirations can be taken care of.
Great, great practice. Well said. Nayan, Can I come to you now?
Sure.
Is there a case for creating groups of various functions roles to create multitaskers as a group? For example, kitchen, restaurants, in-room dining, housekeeping, front office, concierge, laundry, and room service.
So absolutely. Creating multitaskers for parallel functions is there and it's already happening. We've already initiated this in IHCL. So we've already created something which we term it as an A1 team. These are basically associates and even supervisory level people from different operational backgrounds like front office, housekeeping, even FN. And we've kind of mapped it in a way that, you know, there are peaks that happen at various departments at various times and how they, within that shift period of their working, they can be an additional hand to support the smooth functioning, let's say at a breakfast or a check-in time or a checkout time. So this is something that has been already done and works very well, you know, to be saying that, you know, in more in leisure hotels, in city hotels, and especially the large and high volume hotel, there is a little, you know, it becomes a little handicap, but still we have gone ahead and we've pushed it and we've got success on that. Even, you know, for example, the F&B, again, you know, the services used to be very specialized because somebody joined a particular restaurant, if it was a specialty restaurant, probably worked, you know, the maximum over there. Now they are just moving within the shift of different areas. And that, of course, you know, Meena mentioned about right sizing in the beginning, and that is a result of the right sizing also and giving opportunity. And because of, you know, the restrictions that were put in, X restaurant operating, not operating, only IRD operating. And even we even went further step, even in our the food delivery platform that we initiated on ourselves, which is called the Cumin. We even utilized our F&B professionals over there. So, you know, that is there. Having said that, you know, kitchen, everybody has been saying that, you know, it is a specialized area. Yes, we have had very few examples. But even in kitchen, if we talk about, generally, the norm has been that probably they specialized in one cuisine. But, you know, I have personally seen people, and especially I'll take an example of the bakers and the pastry chefs who kind of never grew up to an executive chef level, dominantly in most of the places. Having said that, top of my mind recall is actually two executive chefs of various Taj hotels. And one is large, Taj Lands End, and also the Taj Lake Palace, both initiated their careers as pastry chefs. And while working across the cuisines and working across the different areas of the kitchens, they have grown into those roles. So they're kind of role models for a lot of people. And our own chef, the executive chef at the Taj Palace, is again a master baker. So we've given that.
That speaks loads about the Tata management and their respect for people and their respect to help people grow. We'll move to you, Vineet. Is there room for creating multitaskers from backend and support functions?
Vineeta, that's an excellent
IT
question.
IT, security, finance, and HR?
Yes, absolutely. I think that's it's a great area of opportunity. Just to let you know, in my personal experience, I've had a security officer, head of security, actually take on the HR role and is now heading that function and doing an exceedingly well in that area. Similarly, I had an engineer who was very good at assembly line when he had set up his education in terms of specialization. And he had actually become the person who would look after all volume packing and for home deliveries, et cetera, which we used to do, and including large catering for ODCs, that because he was very, very good at assembly line techniques, which he required at that point of time. Having said that, there's another part that we always look at, which we all must have spoken at some point of time in practice, is let's cluster IT, let's cluster finance, let's cluster HR, which essentially goes into multiple properties being looked after by one specialist or one agency. But if you look at it in another opportunity form, then you can actually have an IT and a finance clubbing done together. Similarly, HR as well as finance being done together on the property itself and leading to specialized efficiencies for any particular business model that we might be looking at. And we're not specifically speaking about large box hotels where there are 400, 500 room, etc. You also have beautiful hotels which are just 50 rooms, 100 rooms, 25 rooms. And that's where I personally feel that getting these multitask individuals would really, really help in contributing locally, because sometimes some challenges have to be looked at a property level than otherwise.
Well, sir, Mr. Rohit Arora, how does the GM lead this change and create a changed environment, leading by example?
Vinita, I feel that GM in a hotel is like a captain on a ship. So it's not only responsible for a great and a smooth operations, but also responsible to guide the teams. So leading by examples, I myself is an example for that. I moved from many areas to this position. And I personally feel that it is imperative that a leader should look for ahead for a future, like what is a career path we can give and accordingly adapt. Given this multitasking thing, obviously there will be some stars, and if we can show them the path that, if we are open to this, there's no limit and you can reach to the desired positions. You have to deep dive yourself and show them that, means like if you are adapting this, you have a greater chance to move faster in your careers.
Vinita, you are an area general manager. How will you lead this charge of defining change?
I'm going to say something a little sensitive. And it just came to my mind when everyone was talking. And one of the things is, as a culture, as Indian culture, when you're very small, there are certain roles that are given to you based on your gender. I'm sorry to bring this up, but it's true. There are a lot of men who don't want to wash dishes. So during the pandemic, for example, we did have a few chefs who thought, it was below their dignity to wash dishes. And it comes from a deep-rooted, bringing up that they come in. We have, for example, in the beauty parlor, a person who cuts hair will not do a pedicure. Now, these are cultural issues which need a lot of delicate handling, very, very delicate handling. However, no one envisaged that the service would take such a turn. As someone rightly said, there are decades when nothing happens and there are weeks when decades happen. The biggest challenge of our industry at that point of time was delivery of safety, with no loss on account of the smiles which were hidden below a mask. So masked warmth was the need of the hour, yet people wanted a single stop shop. They didn't want to interact with too many people. So perforce, there was a very big need to be able to convert this need into a one-person shop. And so he had to be multi-skilled. So now it was to challenge that was faced before us was to reorient our associates for a conversion of the moments of truth to the moments of trust, as my our director said. How did we achieve this? We decided that training was very important. So we created a plan. We communicated effectively, keeping in view all the barriers that they have, in cultural barriers that they have, also to tell them what the end goal was, to also tell them of the small wins, the low-hanging fruit that we got every time we were able to multi-skill. We identified key players. We delegated action, we set realistic goals. We also had motivational rewards in as and when this entire process took place. We managed expectations, we ensured accountability, and finally, monitored progress. Privacy being the new luxury with trust, which was the new currency, and health, which was the new wealth. So there were certain best practices. I can keep going on about it, but I'll tell you, one of the biggest things was functional prejudices. Functional prejudices had to be discarded. Functional heads were given the liberty to recognize cross-functional teams. This was achieved by incentives, recognition, structural training. Associates were keenly observed to identify their skills and their inclination towards other functions that would complement their strengths, thereby enabling multi-skilling. Service excellence was redefined. The Namaste became silent but gained greater power. New level play field designations were given, were gaining prominence, like hotel operations agent, rooms division manager, restaurateur. Departmental KRAs started including teamwork with cross-functional departments and unified goals. The concept of a manpower store is what I'm been working on. Departments requisition multi-skilled daily flexi manpower with the HR manager as the storekeeper. The challenge of tips is something we need to look at for it to be equitably distributed based on levels rather than as per department or which restaurant they belong to. Some self-learning, of course, automatically, organically happened because there was this great hunger for upgradation of skills, especially when it came to technology. We needed to provide the motivation and encouragement on an enabling platform that helped enhance cognitive skills, improve productivity, and of course, thereby control costs. While multi-skilling was the need of the hour, we also needed to recognize that some specialists are important. They need to be nurtured because they add to your competitive pegs. Some initiatives that we took in the organization, we standardized uniforms to be able to enable quick transfers. We put in recognition skills, teamwork awards took center stage against individual awards. Coexistence was encouraged with people wanting to eat together from different departments. Recognition programs have been introduced to drive home one simple fact that everybody sells. You don't have to be a salesperson to sell. Everyone is a housekeeper. You don't have to be a housekeeper to clean a stain on a glass. Everyone must look at security. You don't wait for people to nab you for you to call security. Everyone is a social media influencer and above all is a quality inspector. So back of the house areas were encouraged in their grooming standards, in their guest handling skills were taught to them should they ever have to interact with the guests. So associates have the right to approach their supervisor and their training manager for customized training. During valley periods, we made sure interdepartmental temporary transfers took place. Our organization went in to also open job positions. Housekeepers have become general managers. Chefs have opted to be general managers. A case in point is in my own home. My husband used to be an HR person. He moved into general management at some point of time. Of course, he went back to being an HR person again. I can go on as we speak. However, in the interest of time, this strategy is dynamic and will continue to evolve. In your view, which departments do you think will be the most hesitant to this change?
I think some of the areas which we find it difficult, you know, to get into the mindset. Engineering is a very technical line. And even if they want to, it's very difficult to kind of get them to do other jobs. And I think finance, for that matter, where they have specific functions. You know, the income accountant is an income accountant. The credit manager is a credit manager. The cost controller is a cost controller. So these are the couple of areas where we do find it difficult, for people to change their mindset. But I'll take you back to 30, 40 years when I joined the Imperial first time in 96. There were, in a housekeeping, there was a houseman and there was a room boy. The room boy would not clean the bathroom and the houseman would not set up the room. It was a total demarcated job and we were having extra people. So it took us, about a couple of months to change that. And finally we said we are doing away with all that. So there'll be only one person doing the room. So that was one of the challenges. If you go back to, you know, many years ago. So the main two areas are these, where there are systems, but where also we find it very easy to be flexible is front office. I've seen that area is much easier to handle. Training department. My training manager has been really helpful in integrating the various functions that we have put into place, especially with the pandemic guidelines. The director of materials, for that matter, he's a purchase manager, took charge of food and safety and the entire COVID protocols. So here things were easier. But at the same time, when we break up a department like food and beverage, let's look at the service part of it. The people who've been here for like decades, it will be very difficult to get them to change and do a different job. Whereas the younger lot, the GSEs and the GSAs coming from catering institutes, we find it easier within that department, for them to be trained. For instance, another example where the gym manager, I used him as a hostess at the coffee shop number of times because he's used to handling guests. So he would come out during the rush time and handle seating at the restaurants. So the challenges are there. It's all in the mind, I think. It's all about, changing your mindset. Some people you cannot change. If you take individual cases, I can list out a few. But then it is up to the individual to, say, okay, this is a time. If I need to survive long in the industry, I need to change my mindset.
I think it's all been said. Binita, first, it's never too late, right? We must do it now before it's pushed on us, right? People who are living within there, are working within their comfort zones, really need a shake up. They need to wake up and they need to smell the coffee, right? Not just multitasking. Multitasking means you should be able to do two or three roles simultaneously, right? So there is a cost factor to it. There are a whole lot of other factors to it. There are redundancies. Roles will become redundant over a few years, right? With the advent of digitalization, so much more has happened. Mm-hmm. Having said that, this has been a very, very good show. I'm truly, truly excited to start the series and really lucky to be able to bring you people to the screen and share your views with the audiences. Having said that, keep coming back. BW Hoteliers planning a lot of new stuff. This series is going to go on every Thursday for many Thursdays, right? Our next show, which I want to introduce here, will have luminaries as good as you guys are, right? You're stalwarts of the industry, very tall leaders. There are hundreds of years. I think there are about 300 years of experience between all of you here, right? So considering that Vijay has done 30, how many years have you done, Rohit?
Yes, 30, sir.
So Meena's done 40. So it's easy to tote up. It's nearing 300 years. So the next show is going to pick up another interesting topic, which we have, which we really need in the industry to kick up. Missing the big fat Indian wedding. Is small the new big? What about the revenue shortfall that needs to be picked up and how? All right. So, yeah, Anupam, Meena, Vijay, Rohit, Nayan, Vineet. Thank you, everybody, especially Binita. You've been a wonderful moderator.